Good evening, everybody. Thanks for joining us here on the ice, brought to you by Pure and Attic Case Financial Group and Doak's Bulk Fuels. My guest this evening is an old acquaintance friend. I've known her for, gosh, almost 20 years now. I don't want to age the go back in the Wayback Machine too much, but Dr. Missy Holas, medical director of the PWHPA, the Professional Women's Hockey Association, as well as an office as a chiropractor in Michigan, will join me this evening. We'll tell a little bit of stories, how she got involved with the Professional Women's League that has had two of their five or six showcases this year. And we will continue to discuss many of the things in and outside of women's hockey. She may have a different accent. Don't let that throw it off. It's just what we do in Michigan. It's how we kind of met, actually. We'll get into that a little more here on the ice. And as promised, is Dr. Missy Holas. Hello, Dr. Missy Holas. How are you this evening?
Hi. Thanks for having me talk.
It's fantastic. I haven't heard that name in ages. That's fantastic. I don't know if you heard the intro, but I had to go back in the Wayback Machine. It'll almost be 20 years since you've met me, and then you met my brother even before that.
Yeah, probably 20 years. Yeah.
It's insane. And we have many acquaintances in the hockey world, mostly on the East Coast, mostly in Georgia, and as well as playing in Michigan area and whatnot. So great to have you on the show. Thanks for taking the time. I know you've been super busy traveling and taking care of the office. A long day, as you said. Tell me a little bit about what you've been up to in the last couple of months. Just real quick, who is Dr. Missy Holas?
Yeah, so I'm a chiropractor, and COVID kind of threw a little bit of a loop the last year or so, but I am first and foremost a mother of twins, single mom by choice. So those are the love of my life right now. And I am also a chiropractor, and I do specialize in sports injuries and specifically hockey. So I've been around hockey for many, 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 many years. I would say probably 25 to 30 working in it, specifically working as a chiropractor in it, just over 20 years. But the last year, I moved to Michigan from Chicago. I was also had a practice in Atlanta. I was just all over the place, and obviously having kids kind of slowed everything down. But I opened a practice here in Michigan, and I see, I would honestly say about 80, 85% hockey players.
So you like the sport of hockey, to say?
I love it. But I feel like everyone should just kind of have their niche, you know, and it's kind of what I did. And it's the personalities, and it's the people, and it's the game that I love. So, and it's the injuries. I really, truly enjoy the injuries and preventative maintenance of those injuries. And, you know, I work with the men and the women, and I work with 18-year-olds in the National Development Program. So kind of all over the spectrum of things.
Kind of in a hotbed of hockey, would you say? State of Michigan, state of Illinois, those northeastern states. Hockey's been able to be played all year, but when you go just above the border, it's been dormant for almost over a year now. And it's been kind of depressing up here, but have you enjoyed watching the beginning of the NHL and seeing these professional leagues start up again finally?
I have. And, you know, I hate the fact that I don't watch as much as I used to. I mean, I was glued to the TV all the time. And, you know, again, that there's a little different priorities now in life, but my kids watch hockey and they're one. And especially my son loves it. But we literally fall asleep every night to some type of game. And I'm jumping back on the Detroit wagon. And now I have to be a fan of my home team, right?
Got to support the Wings. I mean, they had their glory days in the 90s. I mean, but I think they'll come around hopefully sooner than later. They got to get out of that basement, right?
Yeah, it happens. They restructure all the time, right?
Tell me a little bit more, Missy, about your current position with the Professional Women's Hockey Players Association.
Yeah, so I've worked with the USA Women's Hockey for about maybe 12, 15 years or so, on and off, just helping out at camps and helping the women out. And I've loved it. I love working with women. It's they're such a great group of people. And, you know, same thing with the men. The people are kind of come and go. So there's been different teams and different players, but I feel like a lot of the same core people are there. And then they formed this league last year. And so they came to me and just said, can you oversee everything? Can you be kind of the point of contact for all these different teams? Everyone's got their certain trainer in their area. And I would love to, I wanted to be involved. I volunteered my time and said, I'll do anything to help you guys out. So, it just kind of I got thrown in last year, and we had, there was four or five, maybe even six events last year. I went to most of them. I only didn't go to one. I was 36 weeks pregnant, and crossing the border was a little bit kind of shaky, especially being with twins. So, but everything went off with a hitch. And I think it was great that I trust the people that work for each team. I love seeing their successes, and I'm just kind of there to be a liaison between the medical world and kind of the players and the staff, things like that.
So are you overseeing the training staff and the conditioning staff, the medical practitioners that are with each of the five regions? Is that you're overseeing then?
So each region has an athletic trainer. And then they have people that they refer to, because there's no quote unquote team doctor, I don't think quite yet. So the athletic trainers are there on a day-to-day basis. There's some of them have strength coaches that they work with. And then everyone kind of comes back to me if there's questions, if there's concerns. COVID's been a big thing. I'm kind of the COVID police. When people need to be tested, how things go about if they do test positive for it. We're trying to keep numbers obviously low and that everything is good. But especially these past two weekends, we had to be tested 2-3 times before we got there. And then once we got there, because there is travel involved. So I just call myself the COVID police.
COVID police is part of the job description now. Has these Zoom calls made you more proficient in having these conversations with the regional trainers and practitioners that are involved? Are you getting more familiar with how to use this technology? And is it making it easier to have these conversations, or would you rather still meet in person?
I mean, honestly, I'm a toucher, I'm a feeler, I'm a quality time person. So it's not my favorite. No. I don't really like looking at myself on a camera, especially after a long day. But you know what? It is what it is. And it's better. And I am a FaceTime girl with my friends and family, especially when COVID hit. And I mean, we were 46 days with no adult coming in here to actually hold my kids and to hold me for that matter. So, I mean, it's the best it can at this moment, but it works, I guess, for right now. But in the future, I want to be at all events. I want to see the players. I want to see the staff. I want to be more involved day to day.
No doubt. You are definitely one of those hands-on people. I do remember seeing you put in the hands on the Stanley Cup on numerous occasions. Yeah. You've rubbed shoulders with some tremendous hockey people, both coaches, players, prospects, males and females. Has it always been hockey, Missy, for you? Like, when you grew, did you play hockey growing up? I mean, I never asked you that question.
No.
I mean, do you have siblings or cousins or friends that got you involved in the sport, or because it's that type of playing?
I'm a triplet and we're girls. We had all buddies always around. And yeah, I mean, buddies played. We had ponds out in the backyard and we definitely quote unquote skated and played around, but nothing organized. And no, I honestly think it was to have a good relationship with my dad. He loved watching hockey and then I chose to like it. And honestly, it just kind of trickled from there. And if we all know the people that are around hockey, they suck you in. I liked being around them. And you know, when I went to chiropractic school, I first got there and I just didn't really even feel I had friends that I liked that much, you know, like I was just around people. And it wasn't until I met the hockey people when I became one of the trainers that I felt like I was home. And so now I just realized that hockey feels like home for me.
We could name drop for the next hour, Missy, of the people we've still rubbed shoulders with, but
yeah,
I mean,
just people, and they just are people that I work with. You know, I tell that to a lot of people because at the end of the day, people go out and have a drink with people they work with. People 20 years later meet up with a coworker that they've worked with. And these are just people that I've worked with over the years. And they truly have become family. And that's the way I've kept it. But I've also I've done everything I possibly can to be the best doctor I can be for them. And I know they appreciate it. So
how did you find out about Life University? What brought you to Atlanta, Georgia, or Marietta, Georgia, I should say?
I actually think it's a great story. So there was a couple different chiropractic schools. One was in Iowa, one was just outside Chicago, and one was in Atlanta. And probably the best school in my mind was Iowa, but I was ruling Iowa out because I wasn't going there. no offense against Iowa people.
I did the same. So
I didn't think that. So the one outside of Chicago, and then there was one outside Atlanta, and the Atlanta Thrashers that weren't even the Thrashers were going to be there. And I thought, well, they're going to need a team chiropractor. So why don't I go to chiropractic school and be the team chiropractor? I mean, talk about dream big. Like, first of all, I was female. I was 18 years old. Like, I didn't even know the steps to get there. And truly now I look back at it and I didn't take no for an answer. I really did weasel my way into things. And then I just tried to keep getting better and more educated to be the best so that they didn't have a choice but to keep me around.
And so you did your undergrad at Life, then you finished with your doctorate at Life.
No, I did my undergrad in Michigan.
Okay.
And then I got a master's and a doctorate at Life.
Okay. So finish the undergrad back home. You head down to Life. Did you know who Coach Dan Bouchard was? And what was your first instance of meeting this French Canadian guy with the most incredible vocabulary as a coach in Atlanta?
Hi, Dan. I love you. I had no idea who this was. Like, I didn't know my history of hockey whatsoever. I mean, I knew French players, obviously, but like, you're right. His accent's so strong and so, I didn't even know what these words were that he was saying, but it was pure comedy to be on a bench with that man. And I felt like sometimes we had to calm him down, and other times it was just pure laughter. So he's always been a part of my life. He's a great part of my life. I every memory that I have of him is absolutely the best. Yeah, I like this guy.
Yeah. I remember the first conversation I had with him too, and I knew who he was. I didn't know why and how he was talking to me. It was very, very impressive nonetheless. And getting to Atlanta was a lot of fun. What was it like graduating and then working with the Thrashers and, you know, that first couple of seasons? I mean, like you said, they were just in Atlanta. They weren't a 20-year team. And what was it like for you being a female working with these professional hockey players?
Well, first I ran the on-ice entertainment and coached little kids how to play hockey and things like that. And, you know, I just kind of got thrown into it, and I kind of learned on the way, you know, and I was in school, and then I just kind of fell into the position, and truly, like, they were my buddies. Everyone was my age. I felt like they were all about family and having a good time in like a professional manner. And everyone was losing. Like, the games were not that great, but, it was just fun, you know, and I never took anything seriously. I never thought in my head, oh, this could be a Hall of Famer or this is an NHL player. Like, those things didn't cross my mind. I just thought, this is my job and we're going to it and we're going to have fun with it. And I truly am a happy human that loves life. So I just was living and loving life.
And you did quite a good job at it because you've been everywhere and anywhere in the United States with hockey. And it's great to hear. Now, you're just not a chiropractor. I mean, we both have that rule that there should be other tools, utilities we use on the side. And when it talks about injury prevention, you talk about prevention. I use the word prohabilitation versus rehabilitation and injury prevention being proactive. What other tools do you have in your belt, so to speak, Missy, that helps with not just competitive athletes, but with general athletes to stay in their tip-shop form?
I mean, there's so much. And I think that why I differ myself from a lot of people is that I'm not a run of the mill person. Not everyone gets the same treatment. It literally is what's happening with you mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually. There's so much around it. You know, I use a lot of acupuncture needles for dry needling, but then sometimes I use it more on the acupunctural aspect of things. I do a lot of chakra healing. There's times where I'm just touching a patient or doing basic trigger point therapy. It's just, what I love about it is that I'm pretty sure anyone can say they didn't walk into my office and get the exact same treatment every single time. There might be some similar things and things that we run with that are working, but I would say that everyone is just different in that I kind of see you're a defenseman, you're a goalie, you're a forward, you're having this issue, you are not having an issue at all. We're going to prevent those things from happening because it's the beginning of season, or as of right now, we are in the middle of season and it's everyone's in it. People are losing weight. People are breaking down. And so we just need to build everything back up. And then in the middle of July, we do a lot of restructure stuff and we do a lot of maintenance care and things like that. So preventative is, to me, one of the key things that I pride myself into keeping them going.
We talked to a lot of different athletes, younger athletes, Missy, on the show. And I continually stress the fact that there needs to be an off season. There needs to be a break from your major sport you play. I mean, you agree with that, obviously.
Totally.
How important is that physiologically for the body to get a reset, not just physiologically, but mentally as well?
I think mentally, like, I remember even just, I mean, it's gotten a little bit better, but like having an off day, right? We have an off day. don't even go to the rink. You need to think of something else besides hockey, and everything is so hockey. And I just was saying to one of my players the other day, and I'm like, it's just a game. And the truth is, I know it's their life. I know it's their career. I know it's the deal. But at the end of the day, you need to take a couple hours and just mentally break. I think that's way more important sometimes than the physical aspect of stuff. But yes, I think summer or the month of May, especially in hockey, if you're out in April, take the month of May off. Nothing's going to change. Your body's going to know exactly what to do, especially when you give it rest. So I 100% agree with that. I love when people play multi-sports, when there's kids playing soccer and baseball and volleyball and running or doing ballet or whatever it may be. I think this stuff is great.
No doubt. Cross-training is a huge proponent. We're seeing a lot of major athletes coming out and saying, you know, back in the day, I did play baseball. We're seeing professional athletes getting drafted now in two different leagues, the NHL perhaps and Major League Baseball and football per se. So we're going to take a quick break, Missy. Just hang on. We're going to talk more about the two showcases that took place and some of the nuances you got to envision and be a part of in both of those cities. So stay right here. We'll be back here on the ice. Back with Dr. Missy Holas, I guess the medical director of the new Professional Women's Hockey Professional Women's Hockey Players Association. It's a tongue twister. I'll get it ready once in a while, but this is not the Northwest Hockey League. There was the other hockey league that's involved. This is still a tied with the NHL teams, and you were able to be involved with two showcases in two pretty prominent rinks. Madison Square Garden, which I've been to as well, and the United Center in Chicago. What was it like, first off, seeing the excitement in the air, feeling the excitement of this first showcase in New York City?
You know, it was awesome. Like, obviously, I'm very excited to be involved, and it's the first event, per se, because of COVID. There was a lot of protocols that we had to go through, and there was just a lot of things behind the scenes. So I would honestly say a little nervous. Like anyone has had a COVID test 2 days before you leave, you're like, well, I hope it's negative. You know, I don't know why it would be, but, or why it wouldn't be, but ultimately I was a little nervous going there and, making sure everyone was okay and everyone would get there in time and everyone was going to be okay. Everything was going to go smoothly, but, it was awesome to see the girls together, everyone's excitement. Madison Square Gardens was, you know, I have been there as a fan. I've been there behind the scenes because some of my players have played there and just gone to see them. But I've never been there to, quote unquote, play a game. And, you know, because of COVID, because of having the babies, I'm not working for a team right now. I'm kind of an independent contractor. So I didn't really think I missed being at the rink. You know, there's times and moments, but I still see the guys. I still have the camaraderie. I still have groups of time with them. So I still feel like I'm in the locker room. And it wasn't until I got in there and I smelled the ice and I saw the girls go out for the lineup and I could hear the noises and I'm like, oh boy, I missed 7 o'clock. I missed 7:30. I just missed the games. And, you know, I just was so grateful to be there. You know, I did a little bit of treatment. I made sure that we were all good COVID wise. I wouldn't say that I was overly crazy busy. Like I am kind of at the office, but, everything went smoothly. It was just great. It was a great, great atmosphere and it led right into another weekend days later. So, it was a very exciting 2 weeks.
Like, yeah, you went straight from New York City and then I contacted you and you said, I can't really talk until later on. I got to go straight to Chicago. Cause that's what the schedule was entailing. It was just another showcase in another major city in the United Center.
Yeah.
How was it? Were the two cities different at all? Was it the same protocols being followed? Give us a little bit of a difference in what's been happening between the two showcases.
Same protocols, especially COVID wise. I mean, we really are kind of quarantined. the week before we went to New York, and we stayed quarantined besides obviously the travel, although we were tested multiple times throughout the weeks, going in, going there, and then we're quarantined kind of to our hotel. So I will say Chicago felt a little bit more like home. I lived there for almost 8.5 years. So I went there on a Tuesday. I did have to bring my babies with me. So I just want to get settled. But I was in quarantine, so I couldn't see my friends, which made me a little sad, but that's okay. So I saw them afterwards. But it was just, to me, walking into the United Center, again, I haven't been there in, well, like a year and a half, but I'd go there all the time. And I loved being there, whether I was there to do treatments, whether I was there to see a friend play, or whether I was a quote unquote fan. I just missed it. And I especially missed United Center because I really do miss Chicago more than anything.
Showcases are a little busier than an NHL season, but there still is a little bit of downtime. How much, I have to ask you this question personally, Missy, how much do players, teams, organizations miss the social aspect of the time in between games? I mean, it's going true. To restaurants, hanging out, going for a walk through the mall. How much of that is missed? And have you seen that in the play in the two showcases you've been with?
Yeah, so I mean, looking on the developmental teams, the younger kids, like, yes, they're together, but I feel bad. They're 18-year-olds, and they can't do the normal things that 17-18-year-olds would do. You know, not as they're getting in trouble or drinking or anything like that, but like ultimately just doing team bonding things. And then the NHL guys, like, yeah, they miss being together. They miss quote unquote Super Bowl parties or Halloween parties or Christmas parties or just going to dinner on the road. You know, that's the fun part of allowing yourself to let go of the crazy schedule that the hockey world involves. The women's team, it is. We were rushed in on a, oh my God, I know it was Friday. You're tested Friday night. You're quarantined in your room. Saturday, there's a game. Sunday, there's a game. So there's a little bit of treatment in there. There's a literally grab your dinner, grab your lunch, and then you go to your room. And so I will say, I also see the sadness in it is that, you're just not around anyone. You know, it's very isolating. But the Chicago, I feel, was a little bit better because it was a little less downtime. We had an afternoon game and then it went right into a morning game. But I feel like it's going to get better. I hope it's going to get better. It's just different, you know?
We have two hubs regions in the States, three in Canada. The three in Canada obviously did not cross the border.
Right.
We need that border to open up so we get to see all five regions together in a more of a 4-day showcase as opposed to just two teams battling it out.
Yeah. And the thing is, those two teams had a couple different players that went in there, but you need to see a little bit more competition within having more teams, which it'll grow. This league is brand new. It's going to grow. Those borders are going to open. We're going to be able to play each other. Yeah, there's a lot of excitement behind it, and it's gonna keep growing and getting better. And it just, the buzz is buzzing, like things are buzzing.
Madison Square Garden had the NHL Network, had Rogers Sportsnet televising the games. You had CBC streaming it here in Canada. And on just outside of the media aspect, how important is the relationship between the PWHPA and the NHL? Why is that going to be allowing this to grow even further? Potentially see more regions, more players involved. And just get that excitement for a professional women's hockey division league.
Yeah.
Just like the NHL.
I'm not in marketing, so I don't really know how this goes about or how you do it. But ultimately, what was awesome is you see the NHL players backing up these ladies. And they're not asking to make millions. They're just asking to make a living. And I think it's very fair. I think as women, like, yes, we should be able to make a living doing what they want to do for a living. And that's what it's leading to. And that's what's great. It's just to have the support that they're looking for behind them, you know?
Absolutely. You talked about you not being a marketing person, but one of the marketing aspects of this showcase is this point system that is different. You love it. I think it adds excitement. I've talked about it on another show in terms of double IHF point systems, but an overtime win will get you 1.5, 2.5 points.
We'll talk about it. At first I was like, what is this? Kind of cheesy, like what is this, like I don't understand. And then it came into play at a game at Madison Square Gardens the last 2 minutes, and I was like, oh my God, if Brianna Decker scores a hat trick, they actually automatically win. Like, and then I was like, oh my God, do they know that? Do the coaches know that? You know, I mean, yes, they knew that, but like obviously Bree didn't want to leave the ice because she wanted to score. And then, but the opposite team shadowing her the whole time. Like it was very exciting, but I could see where that could come into play and just be, pretty cool, you know, to win a series or a weekend series like that, because of the point system.
Yeah. I mean, a regulation loss is 0 points. A regulation win is more. Overtime wins a little bit more. It's got a half point added.
Yep. Five goals.
Yeah, I mean, if you get a hat trick, you get an extra point for your team. If a goalie gets a shutout, you get a point. I mean, all these different factors play in. And does it for a coach? I mean, thinking, go into a coach's mind for a second. Do you think they're coaching with those mentalities now in this league, or is it just something where they want to see the team win in 60 minutes and then play as such?
No, I think that it came into play. Like, I think they want to win for sure. But then in the last few minutes, if you are and that point system is available somehow to you to gain a lead, absolutely. It's going to come into play for sure.
That's awesome. No, I think that's a fantastic, cool little wrinkle to the old ways, and it should add more excitement. Missy, before I let you go, I got to ask you a couple of questions with life off of the ice. Tell me a little bit about your office. Who comes into the office? Is it just hockey players? Is it, you know, more mom and dad? Is it more family? Give us a little rundown of what your day-to-day operations are outside of working with the hockey players.
I mean, truthfully, I have a lot of success in the hockey world. So I think that they've just been referrals. So I would say that I'm probably 85% hockey. With that said, a lot of professionals, a lot of up and coming, probably professionals, but I do see normal people, and probably people more referred to me from the hockey people, but you know, I grew up in this area, so there are some people that I know from that. But I really truly enjoy someone that wants to heal, wants to be better, wants to advance their physical and mental health. So I kind of am staying in that realm. So yeah, some moms in there, some grandmas in there, but ultimately it's a pretty young athletic group.
How has having twins changed your life for the better?
I can't put it into words. Everyone that has kids knows it. The true loves of my life. Like, I just, you know, I do say this, I'm 43 years old and I would have been a really shitty mom younger. I needed to go through everything I went through. I needed to get my career started and going, but I am a way better mom because of all of it that's happened. I have so much patience for them. I don't want to work 80 hours a week anymore. But it's just true joy to come home to, true joy to be around on a daily basis. I love them. I love it.
Walking,
Ford's running, and Charlie's she walks on her knees, tries to keep up with Ford, and then she walks a little bit, and then I feel like it kind of slows her down, so she's back on her knees, so she'll be fine. She's doing great. Both of them picking up hockey sticks though really correctly without me telling them how to do it. They got some jerseys, and a few of the guys came to visit us in the hospital day two of their lives pre-COVID. And so they got kind of spoiled with a bunch of the guys around here. So they know hockey. They love it.
I bet Ford and Charlie have a lot of quote unquote uncles in professional hockey that are just spoiling to death.
So I'm so grateful, because the truth is I've loved all of them and their families, and they're giving me just as much love back. And it's overwhelming how wonderful it is.
Outside of working with hockey players, what does Missy like to do before COVID came around? What kind of, you know, what kept your spirit running?
You know, I'm a traveler. I'm just a seeker of anything. You know me, but ultimately a lot of people don't. And the fact is, like, I'm not a sitter on the couch. I want to get up and do something every single day. And even in COVID times now, we have traveled. I took the babies by myself to Florida. We've gone to Chicago multiple times. I take small little day trips. I just seek adventure.
Do you see yourself staying in Michigan, or do you see yourself planting roots elsewhere?
You know, this is the first time I went to Chicago and I'm like, I'm okay in Michigan. You know, I don't know if it's been like my favorite city per se to live in, food wise or monument wise or art wise or anything like that, but ultimately it's home. And I feel like my career is giving me back so much, because I really am loving my office and I'm loving where I'm at. And it's just good. It's gone full circle.
Okay, so now I got to put you on the spot. Are you wearing Red Wings red, or are you wearing Blackhawk red?
I'm not on the Red Wings train.
On the Red Wings.
Unless I'm in Chicago, and then I have my baby out there. It's funny because I will say Red Wings Florida Panthers game we went to in Florida, and they had their Red Wings jerseys on. And then Florida, one of the old coaches, which was one of my players for 15, 16, 17 years, him and his wife sent the baby's jerseys. So I took off the Red Wings jerseys, and well, actually, I put the Florida Panther jerseys over the top of the Red Wings jerseys. And then Florida scored, and Detroit was actually winning for, like, I think it was like their first win of the year or something, or was leading into it. And I'm like, okay, those are coming off. Sorry, Florida guys. That's the Red Wings jerseys.
That's awesome.
Beautiful, and I love my Florida Panthers. I miss you guys. But yeah, I'm just, you know what? I'm a fan of players not getting hurt, and I'm just a fan of success. And so I wouldn't say that any team is my favorite. I do have favorite guys. I have retired guys that are my favorites, and just again, I haven't really met a hockey guy I don't like.
From an injury perspective, I have to ask you, put your doctor hat on. When it comes to you know, obviously you're assessing injury, you're working on the rehabilitation and working towards preventing it happening again, what could you tell young athletes in any sport, what's the one of some of the most important things they should be doing when they are injured and they have to, you know, not face consequence, but there's a road ahead to recovery?
Visualization. Visualizing. I love teaching them what is going wrong with them, why it's happening, how it's happening, and then visualizing how we can heal it. And I'm probably an over-explainer, but I like to explain every injury and how I'm going to fix it or how they're going to fix it and how we're doing it together. Because it is a little bit of my help, yes, but it's also their body healing. So if they don't know what they're healing, then it is going to slow it down. But, you know, there's also anything from diet to, as we said, just preventive maintenance of other things that are going to help them heal faster.
I would say hydration is up there.
Huge.
And I always tell everybody, you only spend 30 to 45 minutes in my office as a client. What are you doing with the other 23 hours in that day?
Yeah. And a good athlete will listen to you and do it. You know, that's why I love the people I work with.
As a newer mom, how much are you missing sleep?
So I'm not much of a sleeper. I never was. Thank God.
I
don't know. I haven't really felt tired yet. And again, twins, but maybe it'll come. I don't know, but I'm okay. I feel like I'm okay. And I'm, as long as I get 4 or 5 hours of sleep, I'm good. And increments, right? Because sometimes it's 3 and 2, but it's okay.
Fabulous.
They're doing better. I mean, they're almost a year, so they only wake up. I do like a diaper change once around 2 or 3 in the morning, and then we're good till 6 or 7.
There you go. Missy, I'm going to ask you to say hello to anybody before I let you go tonight on the ice.
Who am I saying hello to?
Anybody you like.
Anybody that I've ever worked with. I love you guys. I can't wait to work with you again. And here's what's even more fun. I'm working with kids there. I used to treat their parents. I love that. I think that's the best compliment anyone can give me.
Dr. Missy Holas, working on the old generation and the new generation in Michigan. Is the office in Detroit or?
It's in Troy, Michigan.
Troy, okay.
It's just about 15 miles north of Detroit.
Okay. So you get to see a little bit of the big town. Have you, obviously you've seen a Red Wings game in the new building?
I have. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. How is it? I missed the old Joe. I haven't been to the new one.
I think there's like a good, like just a new generation of coming forward. Like everything's moving and getting better. And it's just the technology there is awesome. The seats are awesome. I haven't been to a game this year yet. And actually I think in like a couple weekends, there's like a 3 o'clock game. It's just, you know, it's tough with at 7 o'clock with the babies. And the truth is I want to come home. I don't want to go to a game, but as I said, I did miss it once I was in New York. So it's a beautiful rink.
Are you a basketball fan, Dr. Holas?
No.
So you're not following Michigan, the Wolverines, you're not following the Spartans. We won't even get into there. We'll keep it to hockey.
I mean, I don't care if it's on in the background, but I'm not paying attention, no.
Dr. Missy Holas, the medical director with the Professional Women's Hockey Players Association, thank you very much for joining me tonight on the ice. I really appreciate the insight. One message, if you are injured, please go take care of yourself. Find the professionals you need and do listen to them because they have gone to school for this. They kind of know what they're talking about.
Tuck, I will say also, I tell this to everybody, be an advocate of your own health. You know, there's a lot of people that don't want to find out the injury or do a quick scan and get you out of their office, but truly find someone you trust that you can maybe stay with, you know, for your career or whatever, but that wants to keep getting better for them as athletes.
So you bring up another point there, because you've been everywhere, Florida, Atlanta, Chicago, Michigan. You've got, we both have relationships all over this world.
Yeah.
And you've built it because you have your integrity is strong. You're honest with your clients and you treat them like your brothers.
Yeah. Like I would to anyone. Like, yes, they are my brothers. 100%. Yes.
And now you have a very large, and now and you're their sister. I mean, I've never had a sister. So they, I mean, when I go to Michigan, I know I can find yourself and Dr. Craig Stoller. He'll drop another name bomb there. I know he's in Michigan somewhere. I know there's a couple other guys, I'm sure. But truly great to catch up with you, Missy. And so love nice. Seeing you smile. And
you too.
Thanks for spending some time with me. We'll let you go. And have a great rest of the evening.
Thanks. Bye, guys. Nice talking to everybody.
Dr. Missy Holas here with us on the ice. Again, the medical director with the Professional Women's Hockey Players Association. Great conversation with her. Do check us out Tuesdays and Thursday nights here on ASTV. Thanks for watching. Bringing more goodness to the greatness. Take care and have a great evening. Bye-bye for now.